It's a brand new day. Hey, hey, hey. It's a brand new day. Halfway twisted, you've been out of shape, and you feel like you've missed it.
Welcome back to Marbella Now. My name is Nicole King, and this week it's all about sailing.
Hey, hey, it's a brand new day. Hey, 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 it's a brand new day. Halfway twisted, you've missed it. You dropped out the race, and as time flies by, you'll open up your eyes wide. You feel it's gonna go your way. Hey, hey, it's a brand new.
We're back in the Puerto Deportivo, the sports port in the heart of Marbella, and we're going to set up camp in the Real Club Marítimo, in the Royal Maritime Club, right here. We're going up now to the members club of the Royal Maritime Club of Marbella to meet Rafael Torres. This place is amazing, far more to it than you could possibly imagine, and very, very special deals if you're a member.
Hi. Hi, Nicole. How
Rafael, buenos dias. Un besito.
Morning.
Good morning.
Thank you for visiting us.
Well, it's an absolute pleasure. Rafael is a sailor himself. In fact, inside there are some amazing photographs of you in action. Mm-hmm. This is the door to the members club.
Yeah.
What is the Royal Academy, the Royal Maritime Club of Marbella?
Our club is from 1956 years old. The real title is from 2 years ago. The King Felipe conceded us the title. Sorry for my bad English.
Oh, it's fabulous. The title, we know, we understand.
Thank you. I will try to speak in English. Our title is from 2 years ago. I am very proud of. We are very proud for this title. No much club in Spain have this real title.
Well, apparently you have to have the club open for 50 years to even aspire to that. And you're coming up now to the 60th anniversary, which is saying something. And I see now the president of the club is the same surname as one of the original presidents.
This is the different president from the foundation to the actuality nowadays, Fernando Oltra. Yes, it's the same address that the first president. This is the board of the different club that we have a relationship with this club and around all the Spain, for example, the north of Africa, Melilla, to Pontevedra in Galicia, Cádiz, Seville, Malaga. If you are a member of this club, Marbella, you have entrance free in this different club.
Well, that's a wonderful benefit. You don't have to actually sail to be a member, is that true?
No tienes que ser uno que navega.
No, en absoluto. En el club, in this club, there are different persons, business people, professional, sportmen, different sport, sailing, fishing, diving, paddle surf, different. It's a comfortable club for different people, Spanish people and foreign people. We are very happy that the foreign people resident in Marbella come to visit us and show our installation.
Well, they are beautiful, and that's what we're going to do. Let's go through that magic glass door and look and see why people want to be members of this fabulous club.
Hey, hey, it's a brand new day. You've missed it. You dropped out the race, and as time flies by, you'll open up your eyes wide. You feel it's gonna go.
So, Rafael, I see there are a lot of great photographs, action photographs of sailing here. Are these people from Marbella? Are you in any of these photographs?
This picture is about different members of the club that the Marbella people didn't say that in Marbella exists really, really nice, really, really good sailors. For example, World Championship, King Cup Championship, Spanish Championship, but they compete in different boat, Spanish boat and foreign boat. This is the different picture, but recognition. For this member of
you were
our club.
Saying that you've got in a Marbella guy, very famous. I can't remember the Iñaki.
Yes, very famous. It's the most famous Marbella. It's Iñaki Castañer. This is his world championship around different years. He's a member of our club. We are proud for him.
To become a member here, there is an initial entrance fee and then a monthly fee.
Yes, it's initial entrance fee. This is for 300 euros. Fee per month of only 37 euros. With this payment, you can, for example, use the saloon, use the other installation of the club. One important thing is a discount in the 20% in the restaurants. It's nice restaurant in Marbella for the member. We have a discount of 20%, and also in our terrace, our daily menu, good food.
And do you have a special price on the daily menu as well?
Yes, a special price with these views. Only two different menus for 12 euros or for 18 euros. Amazing food, really. We trust me.
Yeah, we do trust you,
It's a brand new
So, Rafael, other benefits of being a member are cheaper rates for docking your boat here.
Yeah, this is a different boat of the member of the club. If you are a member of this club, you have to take in our docking or in the dry marine with a hard discount in comparison with the other docking at the port. No? If you... For example, this is a 25 feet boat of the different member of the club for participating in a race, sailing race.
If you don't know how to sail, well, you can also resolve that here, because you have not just summer clubs, but all year round, adults and children can get lessons.
Yeah, this last summer we have 400 children in the sailing school summer camp. In the rest of the year, in winter, we will have a good sailing school for children and for adults in the weekend. We recommend that the people try, because it's an amazing experience and it's a healthy sport. We have a boat, installation, teacher for practicing this sport. In the next month, start a new experience with a member, it's a woman, it's a biologist, and this person has a huge experience about the sea, the animal of the sea, and she start a school for children and adults for different the people know the biology, the sea marine animals, the sea. We will have school diving also. We will have a good experience. It's a different area in the club. We invited the people of Marbella to come visit us.
There's loads of reasons to come, as you can see. Rafael, thank you so much for opening up your doors and welcoming us.
You're welcome, and thank you for visiting us.
We'll be here a lot more, and that's not a threat.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, hey. There's so much going on here at the Royal Maritime Club in Marbella, and Jorge is in charge of the events. We'll get to meet this lovely gentleman Alberto in a minute, because he's like a really serious fisher. But for those serious fishers, and maybe fishermen who aren't so serious want to have fun, Jorge, you've arranged a deep sea fishing competition on the 16th and 17th of September.
Efectivamente, 16 y 17 de septiembre organizaremos en Marbella con el Club Marítimo el segundo torneo de pesca de altura, contando con el campeón de la Copa del Rey de este vigente año y del año anterior, y esperamos que haya una mayor afluencia de gente lo más posible. Contamos con dos días de fiesta, incluida una cena, desayunos, cenas para cuatro personas, grandes premios, trofeos espectaculares y a pasarlo bien.
Well, if you speak Spanish, you've heard that that's going to be a wonderful event. What's going on is the 16th and 17th of September, there is a deep sea fishing competition. You can inscribe on the list to take part up until the last day. All you need to do is know how to fish and want to have a good time, as Alberto said. And it's 100 euros to inscribe for four people, and that includes you docking your boat. It includes a cocktail the first evening, dinner on the Friday, breakfast the next day, and then you obviously get to win not only a fabulous trophy but great other prizes as well. So if you are a fisher person, as to be a fisherman, do make sure you come along on the 16th and 17th. And Alberto, we've just heard in Spanish that you are the winner this year and last year of the big game King's Cup competition. I didn't even know that existed. Enhorabuena, congratulations.
Thank you. Sí, hemos ganado por segunda vez la Copa del Rey de pesca de altura, la competición más prestigiosa a nivel nacional. Y bueno, es un orgullo para nosotros, para Marbella y para el Real Club Marítimo de Marbella.
He's saying he's obviously very proud for himself and also for the Royal Maritime Club here in Marbella to have taken that King's Cup, which is the most prestigious title in big game fishing. And Alberto was telling me before that really Spain, Marbella, is excellent for fishing, serious fishing. We should make more of a touristic emphasis on that. Que debería haber más énfasis en el aspecto turismo para lo de la pesca.
Sí, aquí disfrutamos de uno de los mayores paraísos de pesca a nivel mundial. Tanto de todas las modalidades de pesca, pesca de fondo, pesca de altura, de curricán costero. Tenemos el estrecho de Gibraltar con los mayores atunes que se puedan conseguir con caña. Y lo único que ocurre que, bueno, pues parece ser que las autoridades nacionales pues no se dan cuenta de que la pesca deportiva es uno de los mayores ingresos económicos que existen a nivel mundial.
Well, what Alberto is saying is that he doesn't think that the national authorities realize what a big industry the sports fishing can be. And Alberto is saying that we have literally a paradise for fishing here in Spain. And if you go to the Straits of Gibraltar, you can get some of the biggest tunas that you can catch with a fishing rod. So it really sounds very exciting. Hopefully the authorities are watching our program and can hear that this could be a good extra income. Que quizás las administraciones nos están viendo.
Sí, tienen que darse cuenta. Detrás nuestro podemos ver fotografías de de grandes capturas de atunes grandes que están ahí para cogerlo, promocionar la captura y suelta.
Capture and then release. This is yes. The philosophy yes. of Alberto. Last time we were sitting with Pepequin last year, the King's Cup for yacht sailing was in full swing and Pepequin's team was doing very well. In fact, they came second. But this year, you won. Marbella team won the King's Cup. You must be so proud. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
The beam, the smile says it all. Quite an achievement.
Yeah.
So you were sailing in the, which category?
In the G80. The name of the category is G80, the small boat with 8 meters. And we are 4 people on the boat plus a young person from 9 years old.
And how come? What was the 9 year old for?
Because we need the maximum of the peso.
The weight.
Of the weight in the boat. So we need 30 more kilos. So we call that the guy with 30 kilos and they come with us and we win.
Amazing. So there's a lot of different factors. It's not just getting out there and sailing, yes. but a lot of different things that brought you to that winning point.
Yes, and one of those are the weight, and the next one is for the sail. We need to have the new sail for the race. You know that our first year we finished on the 5th position, 2nd, 4th, 3rd, and last year 2nd. So I talked with all my friends, this year please didn't go because I win the race. And we.
Oh, it's fabulous. So it shows you that if you don't first succeed, keep going. And every year, you've gone up the ladder to the top point. What was it like standing on the podium and being presented with the cup, I suppose, by the King Felipe?
Yeah, King Felipe. He's a very good person. Very good person. And we finished the press giving. We told a little bit about the team, how it was and everything. And I tried to invite him to Marbella.
And what did he say?
Why not? Well, the problem now is all the politicians have a little bit small problem with all the politician situation. But they say that he said that he really loved to come here to Marbella, to the Club Marítimo de Marbella, because we are Real Club Marítimo de Marbella since last year.
It's wonderful. Rafael was explaining to us that you have to have 50 years of a club being in existence to then apply for it and in 2014.
Yeah.
The Royal. We were wondering actually why it was the Royal Club. The Royal It's lovely. You represent Marbella. You called Marbella Team. This was your idea.
Yes.
So how did this come out? A very ambitious project. I'm going to take part in the King's Cup. I'm going to make a team. I'm going to promote Marbella, which has been from day one. Your brand is Marbella Team.
The name of Marbella arrived near 150 different news paper. And we arrived near 65 million people by internet to see the name of Marbella Team. And the value of that is around 6 million euros.
Well,
so it's the turnover of the name of in of the so it's free for Marbella, free for the Club Marítimo de Marbella, and the return is very good.
Very prestigious, and it's really nice that you brought the trophy home. It's quite something.
Yeah.
You just show it to everybody.
Yeah. That is the trophy for the first position. So we try to the next year to. Come again.
You have to keep it up now.
Yes, that is the most difficult thing, but why not?
The rest of your team, including your 13-year-old, the experience, what happened? You won the race. Was it a difficult race or was it a close finish? What was the feeling like in those last moments?
Well, we start with in the second position the first day, and then the second day we start to finish on the first position during all the week. But in the last race, the last minute, we are near to finish second position because we have a very bad lucky with the start. We arrived for the first part of the race on the 12th position, so we need to finish on the first 11th position. So we go over and finally we finish on the 8th position the last race, so we win the race. The race we win the cup.
Well, it's fabulous that you've taken a few minutes. I know you're very busy because apart from your sailing, you obviously work.
Yeah.
And you're involved, we've spoken to you before about CAVE,
yeah,
which is an association for small businesses, really.
Yeah.
Here,
yeah.
So Joaquín, José Obraneja, Pepequin, I'm thinking Pepequin with your nickname. How did you get the name Pepequin?
It's José Joaquín.
José Joaquín, yeah. As I say, but when did this Pepequin come in? I'm
because in Minorca is Joaquín Skin and it's Pepe is José, so it's Pepequin.
So putting those two together. Is that what they call you at work?
No, it's José. In the work, it's José. In the selling place, is Pepequin.
Pepequin. And for the rest of us, just the winner of the King's Cup for Marbella team. Congratulations.
Thank you very much. I invited here all the audience to come here to the Real Club Marítimo of Marbella and to try here. We have the sea, boats and very ship to come here as a member of the club.
It really is. Rafael was explaining to us, I mean, it's so exclusive. We're sitting now in the members club,
yeah,
but you have a private terrace, next yeah, year even a private beach bar,
yeah,
and very big good discounts, yeah, on the fabulous restaurant.
Yeah, yeah.
So you must spend a lot of time here.
Yeah, a lot of time here, and we train here, so it's only 35 euros a month. So it's not money, and today you come here for a restaurant, it's a good dinner.
And all nice fresh seafood, very typically Spanish, actually.
Yeah, very Spanish. It's good tapas for this. Yeah.
Exactly, and right here in the heart of Marbella. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
A very, very good evening to you. It's a baking hot day and I'm taking shelter here at the Real Club Marítimo in Marbella next to this beautiful life-saving raft. It's a nautical theme here today, but actually I'm going to start talking to you about your last will and testament. Wills are often a bit of a conversation stopper when you talk about them. A lot of people think, why do I need a will? I don't have many assets. I don't own a house. I don't have this. I don't have that. It's just for rich people to do, but that's not actually the case whatsoever. Making a will is vitally important for a number of reasons. Firstly, it clears up any confusion. And as you'll know, if you think about it, after someone dies in the family, it's a pretty bad time. Everybody's grieving, everybody's finding things difficult. And so to add in extra complications, for example, what the person wants to happen after their death, is hugely, hugely distressing for everybody. So, if you make a will, you can set out your funeral arrangements, you can set out what you want doing after your death, and this is a very, very sensible thing to do just to look after everybody else. It prevents problems, effectively. In Spain, wills run along a form called forced heirship. So, if you're a British citizen, you're used to writing your will and being able to, for example, give your money or your house to anybody you like. The dog's home, the cat's home, charity, the mistress, it doesn't matter. You can give it to anybody. But in Spain, they have slightly different rules. So your estate, as it's called, would be separated in half. Half would go to your surviving spouse or partner, and the other half would be split into thirds. Now, one third of that has to be divided amongst your children equally. The other third of that has to go to your children, but you can decide in what way. And the final third you can dispose of as you wish. So half to your surviving spouse, a third of the remainder to your kids, divided equally amongst them, a third to your kids in any way you like, and finally you can dispose of that last third of the second half in any way you like, Kudeka, any kind of charity, AAA, obviously Lily would tell us. So, how do you make a will? Well, there's three types of will that you can make here in Spain. The first one is a holographic will, and this is one that doesn't really involve a lawyer whatsoever. But as I'm going to explain, it can cause problems. Anybody's free to make a will. You can make a document, write what you want to happen with your money after your demise, and seal it, put it in an envelope with your signature, and after your death, someone will open that and present it to a judge. Of course, your signature will have to be verified, along with your state of mind having to be verified as well. It can cause all kinds of big, big problems, which you should be aware of. The other type of will that you can make is a closed will, and we often see this in films. You and your lawyer discuss a will, you make it, you take it to the notary, it's signed, it's sealed in an envelope, sent off to the registry, and no one knows the contents of it until such time as it is due to be read. That often happens where there are family problems or where perhaps the testator, that's the person writing the will, wants to leave an element of surprise. But as I say, mostly closed wills like that are left for the films. The most popular type of will is an open will. An open will is made by you and your lawyer. If you're not Spanish, it usually follows a double column pattern, one column in your own language, one column in Spanish. You'll make the will, you'll set out all the arrangements that you wish. Perhaps you'll take advantage of the Brussels 5 clause, which means that you can choose your country of residence or indeed any other country in Europe to deal with your laws of succession. But we'll talk about that more next week. So, you go with your open will, you talk to your lawyer, you put the clauses you want into it, and you'll go with your lawyer to a notary to sign the document. The notary will explain to you everything within that document, and again, you can choose which notary you go and see. You don't have to go and see the one that your lawyer tells you to go and see. If you've got a friend who's a notary, or you know someone's very good and very good at explaining things, go and see them instead. Just say it to your lawyer. It's entirely your choice. Once that will is signed by the notary and by yourself in the presence of the notary, it will be sent to the Registry of Wills in Madrid. That means when anything happens, it's very, very easy to find. Your lawyer or the people who receive your estate can write to the registry in Madrid, get a copy of your will and get it dealt with as quickly as possible. Clearly, there are costs involved as with anything. If you deal with a lawyer, it's likely you'll pay between 180 and 200 euros for the cost of your will to be produced. You'll then need to pay the notary costs, which are around 80 to 90 euros for that signature to be witnessed and sent off. You can do it obviously in your home country as well, and there are notary publics all over Europe. You may well end up paying slightly more than you would in Spain because you're going to need to get the will that you write apostille stamped, which means stamped so it's legal throughout the European Union. And that tends to cost a bit extra and take a bit extra time. So, wills, who needs them? You do. Make a will, talk to your lawyer, even make a holographic will as I explained, but definitely make sure you make a will. As ever, if you've got any questions, patrick.charles.grant@gmail.com. Have a cracking week. Let's hope it's a bit cooler next week and we'll see you then. Take care. Bye-bye.
There's a great Facebook page that I follow. It's called Spanish for Foreigners, Art and Culture San Pedro. Now, they've contacted me actually to let us know that there are some Spanish courses going on. It costs you 160 euros for the whole course, which starts now in September and finishes in June. The time to inscribe in the course, unfortunately for San Pedro, is already finished. It was up today, the 9th of September. However, there is still time to sign up to the courses in Nueva Andalucía. The courses are going to be a lot of fun, and they also do group get-togethers so you can actually practice your language. Now, in Nueva de Andalucía, you can sign up from the 12th to the 14th of September between 10:30 in the morning and 1:30 in the afternoon, and then again from 6 to 8pm. Students can enrol all year round if there are free places. Now, they're easy to get to the places where the courses are being held. In San Pedro, it's in the cultural centre in the Trapiche de Guadaíza, and in Nueva Andalucía, the Art and Cultural School. They'll be doing different levels as well. Both will cover beginner, intermediate and advanced levels. So it's definitely worth checking this out. As I said, 160 euros for the whole course. And apart from these courses, they organise a conversation club for the students, so you get a chance to practice your Spanish with native Spanish speakers. It's a lot of fun, worth checking out. Get some information on the Facebook page for this fabulous opportunity, because Spanish can be simple, but you have to start somewhere. A lot of people prefer to take their own car when going out at night. However, when it comes to time to go home, that might not be the safest or wisest option. For some, just one glass of wine could put you over the legal limit, which means if you drive, you could put yourself or others at risk, not to mention the controls. So, as we're expats living on the coast, this can be a dilemma, because that's what we do. We go out, we try the wines. And that's why Línea Directa have gone above and beyond with this new completely free bonus policy to people who take out car insurance with them. If you're an expat and live in Malaga, then you get to get all the benefit of this trial of safety first people, a free bonus policy for anyone insuring their car with Línea Directa. But what does this mean? That means that if you find yourself in this dilemma and think possibly you should not be driving, you can just give Línea Directa a call. They will order and pay for a taxi, which will take you and your fellow companions who were with you in the car home with up to a 25-kilometer radius, as long as you all fit in that one taxi and you're all going to the same place. You can even ask for them to pick up your car and take that back too. And this is 7 days a week from midnight to 7 a.m. and up to 4 times a month. And this is obviously all in addition to the fabulous insurance that you get with Línea Directa. Being a Spanish company, they cover you by all the local Spanish laws. Plus, they have a fleet of tow trucks, mechanics, garages, hotels, lawyers, whatever you need. Línea Directa truly do cater to our expats' needs. And all we can say is yes, thank you very much. This is a really nice option to make sure we keep ourselves very safe. If you want more information on this, please go to their website, lineadirector.com, or call them on 952-1478-34. That's 952-1478-34, because Línea Directa are putting your safety first.
So you're a business on the Costa del Sol, and you know the best way to reach customers is through word of mouth. But how can you reach more people to grow your business even faster? Before you spend a lot of money on advertising that may never reach your customers, find out how MarbellaFamilyFun.com can help spread the word about your business today. MarbellaFamilyFun.com.
It's a brand new day. Hey, hey, hey. It's a brand new day. Halfway twisted, you've been out of shape, and you feel like you've missed it. You dropped out the race, and it's time.
The last time I was sitting with these lovely young ladies was at the Meridiana for a charity gala dinner, all to do with a Gipsy canine dog exhibition that was on at the exhibition centre in Marbella this past weekend. Well, Llanin is the lady who had the idea of this event, and Anna, the amazing task of putting it all together, not only with the exhibition, but also that charity dinner, which we'll talk about in a second. First of all, Llanin, hello, congratulations.
Hello, thank you, good morning.
It was amazing, the exhibition, the dog shows, the different stands. How did you come up with this idea to do this major dog show?
Yes. First, sorry for my bad English. I began this dog show in 2006 because I had a dog called Gipsy that he go to the heaven with an accident. I am really, really sad, and because she was my everything, my doctor, my confidence, my everything. And I like to show all the people the love that Gipsy gave me. It was my first dog show. And after I study all the therapies for the dogs. I'm animal communicator and therapist of the dog. And last year, in the 2015, was a very big feria in Madrid. And we are conseguimos.
We managed to get.
Yes. That the therapist dogs go in the hospital Gregorio Marañón in Madrid, and in with.
So you mean to help with children. Like therapy for children?
Yes, for psychiatric children, and this year for oncological children in the same hospital. And it's very important because it's the first time that the dogs go to the one hospital.
That's a fabulous achievement.
Yes.
Is there any plans to get this extended through other areas in Spain? For example, here in the Costa del Sol Hospital is a fabulous idea.
Yes. We want to go to all the Spanish hospitals and different therapies, not only for children, for old people and ¿cómo se dice? Alzheimer's. Yes, and all the things, all the people that are sad for what thing, no?
Anna, you organized. Helped organize Janine with everything, as again, congratulations. The gala dinner on Friday night at the Meridiana, that was also to raise money for the Gregorio Marañón Hospital. What was that specifically for?
It was for the program Doggy Smiles. It's the one we are going to make in the oncological area with children, with the association Blue Dogs, Perros Azules. And we are going to help them to work with those dogs in that hospital. And we need to raise funds for that.
Was it a successful event? Did you get the hoped for funds?
Yeah, everybody was trying to help with everything. I can come to the dinner, but I will try to help you with another thing. And
so yeah, people can make donations anytime, and this is to help fund the visitation of dogs into the hospitals to help give that love that people need. Janine, the trade fair was enormous. It was very successful. You had Caroline Stone with a canine body massage stand. The AAA had a stand, but there was lots of dog clothes, food. The exhibitions were fabulous.
Yes, many exhibitions.
We have a lot of
Yes, a lot. And cuentacuentos, like with the therapy dogs, with children in the floor all sitting, and show to the lo que hacen los perros to do the dogs for the children, no? And then the children put carries the dogs and learn, no? Y aprender, no?
It's a fabulous, we're saying it was just really lovely to see your integration with the community. Thank you for choosing Marbella for this year's venue, and hopefully you'll come back next year.
Yes, we hope so.
And everyone now understanding a little bit more, perhaps even more people will go, because think of how wonderful actually getting our dogs into the hospitals to help cure people, help them make them feel loved and give that. Yeah. It's just wonderful.
Yes.
Everybody's loved.
Tenemos una página en nosotros en Gipsy Cannis para poder que todo el mundo que quiera ayudarnos, todo el mundo que quiera ayudar a estas terapias, pues puede entrar allí, puede hacer sus donativos y puede apoyarnos para que la próxima feria sea mucho más grande de cualquier forma.
Wonderful. Janine saying they've got their website Gipsy Cannis and the details are on the screen, and you can go there to see how you can make donations and also to be part of next year's Gipsy Cannis dog show exhibition here in Marbella. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
This next section is sponsored by Línea Directa, tailored-made expat car insurance. In the United Nationalities of Marbella Now Summit, one of the major things we spoke about was how to get around Marbella without having to take the car out. People want to go out for dinner, they want to go for a drink, but obviously if you're going to do that, you can't drive, and so people tend to stay very close to home. Línea Directa were great by extending their policy not only to 26-year-olds, but to any age if you're an expat living in Malaga, that if you insure your car with them between midnight and 7 in the morning, they will pick you up if you're not fit to drive and take you home in a taxi, which is great. But there is another thing that the Spanish are using more and more, and our Patrick uses, to get around a little bit further afield without taking the car, and that is blah blah car.
That's right, I'm a massive fan of blah blah car, Nicole. I love it. It's on the website, it's dead easy to find, blahblahcar.com, and all you need to do really, type in the name of the city you want to go from, the name of the city you want to go to, the date and the time, and all the people that are going in that direction will come up. For example, between here and Malaga, there's always about 20, 30 rides an hour, people coming and going.
Really? Because, that many? What? 20, 30 an hour?
Yeah, because everybody in Malaga works in Marbella. It's that simple, and goes back to Malaga in the evening. So you pay between 3 and 4 euros, depending on sort of peak times. Obviously, the big times to go are between 8 and 9 in the morning, and that's when you pay around 4 euros. But after that, it's 3 euros. And it's just dead easy. You get to meet somebody, you get to, if you're like me and terrible at practicing your Spanish, you have to speak Spanish for an hour each direction. You get to find out about different people,
but
learn
how
about
what
they're
doing.
How do you
know you can trust these people? I mean, you like getting into an internet, is it like completely anonymous? There must be some kind of system, I suppose.
It's a bit like Facebook. You have a profile on there with your name, and people can leave reviews about you, 1 star, 2 stars, say whether this guy's a good guy or this guy's a bit crazy and things like that. So, and because you're booking the ride, so you contact with the driver directly, you send them a message through blah blah car's system, so they always know what ride you've taken in all likelihood. So that, for starters, adds this first layer of sort of trust into it. Secondly, you can check, as I say, you can check their reviews. If it's someone with some terrible reviews, you maybe think, I'm not going to do that, but it seems to work, and it's a fairly good community. I mean, I've never experienced
anything
too awful.
Who do you pay? The driver, the system?
You can pay either the driver or the system. They're starting to introduce a system now where you can just put your credit card details in, you can pay the driver beforehand. And I think probably as blah blah car gets bigger in Spain, they're going to look to do that more, because there may well be some tax implications with it. Sorry, this is my legal brain thinking. But that said, yeah, you just bring 3 euros in your pocket. I always have 3 euros in change. Hop in the car, good chat with somebody, 3 euros at the end. See you next time. And you make friends. You know, I've been for beers with some people I've met on blah blah car before, and it's just lovely. It really is. Get to, as I say, practice.
Hope they're not having
Spanish.
Those beers while they're driving.
No, try not to. You might spill it.
It's a very official system that's growing rapidly, and certainly an option. You want to go shopping to Malaga? Well, maybe you don't have to take the bus or drive yourself and park. You can just go and check out this blah blah car system, and then you can travel a bit further afield,
yeah,
more often, for very little money.
And make some friends while you're at it. You can't argue with that.
You can't argue with that.
No, not at all.
Good Patrick. He's our guinea pig. Trying all these things out for us.
Roving reporter.
The roving reporter. Well, thank you.
Pleasure.
Our legal beagle's now roving reporter.
Hey, hey. Welcome. We hope you have a pleasant stay in our dynamic country. Belgium, land of good living and good working, and a great place to do business in the heart of Europe. Belgian geography is surprisingly varied. In a mere 30,528 kilometers, you will find a whole array of different and interesting landscapes.
Belgium. That's a complicated story, sir. There are 3 communities living together peacefully here. Each has its own mother tongue. In Flanders, people speak Dutch, and in Wallonia, French. There's also a small German-speaking community. Brussels, our capital, is officially bilingual, Dutch and French, although many other languages are spoken there because it's an international, multicultural city.
Now, this is our federal parliament, sir. They make important decisions here for the entire country.
Laws are made here in the Chamber of Representatives and in the Senate. The federal government executes the laws and governs the country.
The communities also have their own parliaments and governments, with complete autonomy within certain jurisdictions. As well as the federal state and the communities, there are also the provinces, which in turn have their own lawmaking and executive bodies. As you can see, a lot of meetings and negotiations take place, but the Belgian model works.
Sir, you're standing in front of the Royal Palace. Belgium's been a monarchy since 1830.
The Belgian king is the head of the executive power, and throughout our history, he's been a symbol of the country's unity. We've always been a strategic and economic crossroads in Western Europe. We can show you this quite easily with a visit to the cultural cities. City life sparkles against an amazing backdrop of stately buildings dating from the Middle Ages, Renaissance, Baroque, Art Nouveau, and daring modern constructions.
Here comes a face.
Belgians are passionate builders, and not just when it comes to grand cathedrals and cities. You can see this inspiration in the visual arts as well.
Belgium today knows worldwide fame as one of the most important centres for comic strips. Our cartoonists make great use of our rich history. In that respect, they are on the same wavelength as the anonymous miniaturists of the Middle Ages and the great masters of the art world, like the Van Eyck brothers and Peter Paul Rubens. The Belgian takes a stubborn and original view of his environment, as you can clearly see when you look at the works of Delvaux and René Magritte. An originality which has brought great success to artists like Jan Fabre, Panamarenko, and Brotars today.
If you would like more information about modern art in Belgium, press 1. If you have worked up an appetite and wish to eat, press 2.
Enjoy your meal, sir. There's nothing quite as Belgian as a portion of mussels with fries and a cold beer, is there, sir? We're famous all over the world for our delicious cuisine, a simple portion of real Belgian fries, or an extravagant meal in one of our famous star restaurants, however you like it. Belgian cuisine is very open and creative. You'll find a wide international selection alongside the classic regional specialities. Ever heard of fusion cuisine? Belgian chefs are happy to incorporate new influences into their creations. And that refreshing, refined feeling inspires the music as well. Known throughout the world, the famous Queen Elizabeth competition sees the very best violinists, pianists, and singers perform in a unique setting. With just as much ear for detail, countless musical ensembles, operatic societies, and soloists bring out our country's cultural wealth to every corner of the world. It's another area where Belgium is surprisingly innovative. Where would jazz be today without the invention of the saxophone by Adolf Sax?
Music always means a party, and a huge number of music festivals lure a highly international audience to Belgian stages year after year. The sheer choice is immense. In almost every genre, visitors find plenty of what they're looking for. Belgians love partying and dancing. Every city or village has its own typical festivities, street markets, parades, and processions.
It's hard for 127 different nationalities to get on, to integrate, to communicate, but knowing more about each other will certainly help. And to that aim, joining us now, we have the lovely Vanessa Van Camp, who is the president of the Belgium Business and Community Club of Spain. Wow, quite a title.
Hi.
Hello. Where are you from, Vanessa? Are you from Belgium yourself?
I'm from Belgium, yes, from Antwerp.
And what brought you to Spain?
Well, I think it is the love for Spain from my parents, because they brought me being a baby, 65, here to Cancelada in Estepona, where they bought their first property.
That was quite desolate then. There was very little things around that area.
Very
countryside.
Different. Yes, very different. And of course, everything was different. There was not too much to offer. There were not that many properties. Also, traffic was completely different, of course. Roads, a different world from what it is now.
And from did you then spend your whole time in Marbella, or have you been moving around? Or?
I've been moving around. Let's say the first years I would spend my holidays with them, of course, because really as a child here at the Estepona region. Then they sold off and we found a place in Valencia, which was near for us being Belgium, of course, still 1600 kilometers. Then I did decide to come and live in Spain and start working. So I opened offices in Valencia, Madrid, Cadiz, Seville and Marbella till 1993.
Doing what?
Real estate and services. Then with several crises, I closed offices and concentrated again on Valencia area. But now on demand of the clients, I did come back also because my business partner, she has been living here in Marbella constantly for the last 20 years. And I've been being around for 30 years.
So you're coming
years.
Back?
Yes, it's
is
my comeback.
Back. It's your, the big comeback.
Yes.
Well, you're coming back. You've got a, your daughter, you just said, is about to start yes. school here as
exactly,
well.
Exactly, yes.
Which has changed also a lot from when we first came to Spain.
Completely.
The quality of international schools
yes.
now is fabulous.
Yes, yes. Before, well, it's a pity, but education in Spain was on a very low level. So either you were obliged to go to private schools or whatever. Now you have a lot of choice for bilingual, all type of schools and education you can choose.
Is there a large Belgian community here on the coast?
Yes, there's a quite large, of course, don't forget Belgium is a small country, of course, but apart from that, we are only 10 million of people. There are about 40,000 Belgian people in Spain currently. So apart from all the tourists.
Oh, it's a very significant number.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And the Belgium Business and Community Club, how did that start? How does that help the people that are living abroad?
Okay, how did it start? As I said, I do real estate. And the way of working with our clients brings us to a relation of a lot of confidence. So in the end, they would phone us to see at what time the bus goes, the church opens, etc., etc. So we thought we had to separate this. One thing is the job, and the other thing is really the service and help people. So we started with the idea in 2014, so it's quite recent, how we could be a referential point for Belgian people that wants to come to Spain and needs to know what to do, what to prefer to prepare before living here, coming on holiday, rental, etc. But also for the Belgian people that is already in Spain, to bring them in contact with other Belgian people, but also to integrate them in the Spanish community. And then to bring in contact all type of communities and nationalities that want to know anything or to be together with us.
What, you're lovely people. I have, unfortunately, I've met a lot of Belgian people, even in Madrid, I had some Belgian friends. We've been to Belgium, a lot of times we go to Germany, we actually go to Belgium and then drive through because
exactly.
you don't want to miss that opportunity. It is so gorgeous. But what does Belgium have to offer for our international community? What would you say is that we have, you should look at?
In Belgium.
In Belgium.
Well, of course, Belgium has a lot of history. So it is very important to visit several cities. Every time we talk about Belgium, everybody knows Brussels, of course, and they think about Bruges. But there are other cities like Antwerp, and it's not because I'm from there, but it is really a very nice city around the harbour. Ghent is very nice too, with a lot of history from 16th century and before the commercial part. And then, of course, very good food and beverages. I like the Belgian beers, Belgian chocolates, Belgian
waffles.
Everything.
I mean, it's like there are certain things that we're yes. famous for, our English, our fish and chips, but you have a lot nicer traditional dishes.
Well, there's a lot of offer, really. So Belgian people, they like to eat and drink. So, of course, they want a big offer.
And on a business level, what are the main export products?
Well, there is a difference between the French and the Flemish part. So in the beginning, the French part would be more important because there we would have the mines, the coal mines, etc. But then, and then the Flemish part would be more the where they would have the nature, the apples, for example, are still quite important for most for cider, wine, etc. I'm not sure whether they are exporting them or not, but later on it was taking over, and in the Flemish part they've started very on the high type technology. And of course, you know our famous diamond from Antwerp around, which now really is more the quality and the sales and market of it, because it became so specific that for normal pieces they bring them out to India and to be cut and bring in again. So it is a lot of technology really, and then around of course the commercial part, the harbour, which is a world harbour.
So it must make it very nice, because you've got so many, like here in Marbella, we get to meet so many different people from mm-hmm. different parts of the world, very exactly. international.
Exactly. Antwerp certainly is very international because of this commercial, and the Brussels part of course because of the diplomatic part of Europe.
Well, I certainly say every time I go there I absolutely enjoy going. The people are mm-hmm. very welcoming, very open people, yes. which is surprising because it's not a hot country, which is what you associate mm-hmm. normally yes. with that personality. So it's mm-hmm. quite a jovial
well
race.
I think it all becomes of the commerce, the so many centuries that they know they need people from outside. You cannot do commercial parts just on your own, you need other countries, and they are used to travel a lot. You will find Belgium really everywhere on the world, so I think that's the why they are open to people.
Wonderful. Your club, is it open to only Belgians?
No, let's say that it is mainly for Belgian people, but we have two parts of two sorts of members, the sympathizers and the members itself. Only the members itself, they can vote. The sympathizers is open for everybody, as long of course that you're interested in the Belgian community, as I said, in the way that either to treat with them, to know them, to do business with them. But you can, as long as you speak English, French or Flemish.
And you can communicate.
Exactly. That's the most important thing. We like to know from each other, to interchange culture, just have a nice chat, good food. And of course then the business part is separate.
Exactly. Once you make friends then you see where those things
exactly.
come.
Exactly. And the members itself,
Sorry, no,
the members itself, there we are more strict. You still can be non-Belgian, but we want to avoid that, let's say, to give an example, that Kuwaitis, 10 Kuwaitis, they get to be membership, they want to have the direction, and tomorrow we are not a Belgian club anymore. It could be any other nationality, but just to give an idea that to be a member with the right to vote, there you have to let us know what you want to do, why you want to be in the Belgian community, what you think you can bring to the Belgian community club, because of course...
otherwise you have too many people, exactly. too many cooks spoil the broth, as
exactly.
we would say in England. You have an event coming up very soon.
Yes.
Are we allowed to come to that?
Of course, you're all welcome.
Then tell us about it.
Okay, so our next event will be on the 16th, which is not this Friday, but the following. We are going to celebrate it in Nueva Andalucía, Tudali, which again are
a new
also
Belgium, half-owned Belgian restaurant.
Yes, he's Belgian, she's Dutch, and very nice people. And we are going to have the event there with live music, good buffet, very fine buffet and drinks, raffle. And this is with charity in benefit of a local association, Adintre, from Fuengirola. So that's another part.
And what do they do with this association?
Well, they look after people that has lost their home, or certainly women and children that have been
need somewhere to go.
Exactly.
Well, that sounds mm-hmm. like a very worthy cause. Vanessa, I hope this is the first of many interviews. It's been a pleasure meeting you.
Mm-hmm.
We hope to meet more of your Belgium community over the coming months.
Okay, thank
and,
you.
And if people would like to get in contact with Vanessa and know more. Well, you got the details on the bottom of the screen.
Okay,
thank you very much.
Have a nice day.
Well, that's it for another week. Thank you for joining us at Marbella Now here in the Royal Maritime Club of Marbella. And right now we're standing on the terrace for the Al Levante restaurant. Jean René is the owner. Ooh la la. The food is exquisite. So I think Vanessa, her daughter Minerva, and I are going to hang out, have some lunch here, and you also are very, very welcome. Take care, be nice to each other, and we'll see you next week. Bye. You've been out of shape. And you feel like you've missed it. You dropped out.